Hi, everyone. I'm Svetlana Isakova, developer advocate at JetBrains. In this video, I won't cover any new features available in the new release, but instead, I'm going to speculate about one of the planned language features, value classes. Important disclaimer, value classes are not yet supported. What I'm going to share now is the future vision and the reason for the syntactic change with inline classes. Value classes will be properly added to Kotlin in future versions. If you want to learn about stable features in Kotlin 1.5 release, check the video about inline classes first. The idea of a value class is to represent an immutable entity with data. It can contain many values, not just one. But all of them should be read-only vals. Mutable vars aren't allowed. This syntax with two properties doesn't work yet, but it's planned to be supported in the future. Value class is primarily a data holder without identity. It's completely defined by the data stored inside. Identity checks are even forbidden for them. And that allows major future optimizations. You've probably already guessed that is connected with a big upcoming change in both Java and JVM, Valhalla project. Let's discuss what the project Valhalla is about. Its motto is similar to what we've discussed about inline classes. Codes like a class, works like an int. The goal is to combine the benefits of built-in primitive types performance and the regular classes type safety. And that comes with the native JVM support. Let's dive into details. I'll use the Kotlin terminology, say value classes, but assume they are implemented as JVM primitive classes under the hood. First, let's compare them with the regular data classes. I define a point as a data class data point to distinguish it from a value point from the next slide. When we define two data points, the corresponding objects are created in memory. The variables point1 and point2 store only references to these objects. When we compare two points, Kotlin calls equals under the hood on our behalf, which compares the underlying data. We can also check the reference equality and compare two references. Since they are different, such check returns false. Values stored in variables are highlighted in green. You can see that these values are constants for primitives, but references for all the reference types. The major upcoming change in Java and JVM is that now values of primitive classes, or in Kotlin terminology value classes, can be stored directly. The value classes can be stored in variables on the computation stack and operated on directly, without headers and pointers. It's a huge change in JVM, and that explains why it takes so long to implement it. Since there are no references, the whole idea of reference equality is no longer valid. Let's compare how we pass a data point or a value point as an argument to a function. In the first case, the data point object is stored in memory. So the compiler puts the reference on stack when it passes the argument. In the second case, the value point gets passed directly. Now this object becomes data itself. Note, however, that the value class contains if the value class contains too many properties, JVM can still decide to box it and pass it by reference. But you don't need to think about it. JVM decides what's more optional. One of the main reasons to support this new concept on JVM is to enable flat and dense layout of objects in memory. Array of reference types is always an array of references. That leads to the practice to define two different arrays of primitive values to store both coordinates x and y in performance-critical parts of code. Project Valhalla addresses that by introducing primitive classes. JVM will be able to optimize such storage for primitive classes, again, in Kotlin terminology value classes, and flatten that. That sounds cool. When Project Valhalla lands on Javan, as you remember, I promised to share the future vision and the motivation of why inline classes became value classes. We are really anticipating this upcoming JVM change and want to benefit from it in Kotlin. When it happens, value classes will be implemented as JVM primitive classes under the hood by default. But before that, we don't want to block our users from benefiting from the new functionality. Inline classes do work now, and they are stable in Kotlin 1.5. Note that JVM inline annotation and the whole primitive classes optimization story are JVM specific. On other backends, the underlying implementation is going to be different. For example, analog of Swift structs for Kotlin native. After Valhalla, JVM primitives types will be default implementation for value classes. That's why the current optimization for inline classes requires specific annotation. But even before Valhalla, it's possible to support value classes with several properties and provide an efficient implementation for them in some cases. For example, to replace a value class with several underlying values when it's stored inside another value class or passed as an argument to a function. But it's all speculation at this point. We are planning to experiment with such optimizations, but give no promises whether it's going to be supported in the future. That's all I wanted to tell you about the Valhalla project and its future use in Kotlin. Now let's move on to the next topic, immutability. Working with immutable data becoming more and more popular in modern software development, especially in highly asynchronous systems. Let's see how value classes can help here. Value classes are conceptually immutable. They will be great assistance for implementing immutable data structures. Also, they'll be helpful to implement immutable business entities to be used in an asynchronous environment. We say that value classes are immutable, however, note that this immutability is shallow, in a sense that the member properties can only be vals, but they themselves might refer to regular mutable classes. In this example, a list of tags might be mutable under the hood. Conceptually, you use value classes to implement immutable data structures, but in practice, it's convenient to be able to store mutable objects inside. For example, keeping a reference to a lazy property. Since the lazy class changes the property from a no value to a computed property, it's not formally immutable, but for practical use cases, you can think of it as such. The Kotlin term read-only that we are using to describe collections and var properties might be a better term to formally describe value classes. But since we want to highlight their purpose, we'll continue to call them immutable, keeping in mind that we formally mean shallow immutability. Compare a regular mutable state with a sequence of immutable state objects. In the first case, you store and mutate the state object directly. But if you share it with another component, you should be very careful and share the copy to avoid potential bugs and illegitimate access. If you forget to copy a state object and it leaks to external components, these components might not be aware of the fact that they possess the core entity. Mysterious bugs can arise. In the case of immutable state, you copy it and create a new instance on each update. Therefore, you are safe from the whole bunch of potential errors. You simply can't forget to copy it because copying is the only way to update it. This way, external components always get a consistent immutable version and can't change the core entity accidentally. There is no core entity. Let's see how we update mutable data. Trivial, by assigning new values to var properties. But what about immutable data? One way you can expect it to work, similar to data classes, is to use the copy method, providing new values for properties. However, it's rather verbose and looks more complicated than the previous version. What's more, if we want to update deeply nested values, the difference becomes even more noticeable. In the case of mutable data classes, you simply assign a new value to a deeply nested property. In the case of immutable value classes, the syntax to create a deep copy while only changing a nested value looks rather cumbersome. To provide immutable value classes as a default choice for your business entities, it should be really convenient to work with them in Kotlin. Ideally, the syntax should be no more complicated than the one for working with mutable data classes. Is it possible to achieve that? Yes. Immutable value classes have a good chance of changing your habits so that you'd make your custom classes immutable by default. In order to achieve that, working with immutable classes should be as easy as working with mutable classes. One more hypothetical feature can help with that: copyable properties and copying functions. Let's dive into it now. Copyable properties allow to conveniently copy and modify immutable data. It's a concept similar to mutating functions in Swift, and that works perfectly in theory with Kotlin immutable value classes. You mark a property as copyable by using the copy modifier. Note, however, that the syntax is nowhere near final. After that, you can update the values as usual. But what happens here behind the scenes is that a new copy is created with a new value. The compiler automatically replaces one line updating a value with a corresponding copy function call in the bytecode. You can define regular mutable vars without a backing field in the class body. But as a constructor argument, a var can only be copyable. Thus, you can omit this copy modifier and simply define var. That becomes copyable automatically in this context. For properties inside the class body, you should specify the copy modifier explicitly. You could wonder what happens if you update several properties one by one, whether there'll be one copy call under the hood or several. Most probably, this case might be optimized to one underlying copy call, at least in simple cases, but we'll see whether it's such a big issue in the end. Of course, having only copyable properties is not enough. You should be able to extract repetitive mutating logic into functions. And copying functions are designed exactly for this case. The logic stays the same. State is immutable value class, but you can call the copying addTag function on a var. It automatically creates a new copy, applies the corresponding modifications, and assigns the result to the state variable. We can go even further. Let's imagine we want to update the last update property on any actual change to one of the other member properties, and do nothing if nothing has changed. We can extract this pattern into a separate function and pass the updating logic in a lambda, in a copying lambda. The copy modifier on a function type signifies that you can pass the lambda that calls other copying methods. The update function calls the block on the state receiver and then checks whether it has changed. It means the addTag function might be rewritten to using the update pattern and providing custom logic for updating the tags. It is supposed to work somewhat similar to suspend functions that are only allowed to be called in a suspending context. In this case, you can call copying functions only in a special context, inside other copying members or lambdas. There are much more details about supporting this functionality. I want to repeat that it's not a final decision. Many things might change on the way based also on your feedback. The copying functions and copyable properties demonstrate why we do want to have this feature of value classes even before the major Valhalla changes. But no promises, there are a lot of experiments to be done and ideas to be battle tested. If you want to learn more details, please check the detailed design document on Kotlin Value Classes in KIP. It provides implementation details of how this feature can be supported and evolved, and many more possible improvements and directions along the way. Feel free to join the discussion around it. Your feedback and your use cases are really important to us. Thank you for your attention, and let's Kotlin!